last week's discussion, we looked at the attributes of God, and then towards the end, we looked at this aspect of impassibility. The idea of looking at the attributes of God is that you know, we need to really have a good idea, you know, when you know, people say, you know, they believe in God. So basically, one way to understand God will be to look at the nature of God, the attributes attributed to God. So we looked at some very basic, what they sometimes call active attributes of God: omniscience, omnipotent, and all good, you know, these characteristics. In addition to God being the creator and the sustainer of the universe. So God is all-knowing, all-good, and, you know, can do anything, omnipotent. Now, based on these three characteristics, when we put these three characteristics together, of course, there was a serious thing we have to consider. Now, particularly due to the problem of the presence of what we call evil or suffering in the world, if God is such, if the universe was created by such God, how can there be suffering in the world? How can there be anything bad in the world? Because God can do anything. God is all good. So how can, you know, theologically, this has been a serious problem. Still, it remains a problem for theistic religions. How to explain the existence of bad, evil, dukkha in Buddhist language, existence of such situation in the universe, and then how also can exist like devil, you know, the bad person, like in Buddhism, Mara. Now, for example, in Buddhism, of course, there is no serious issue in explaining the presence of Mara. But then in the theistic religion, if God is such, how can you explain the existence of bad, existence of evil? So it remains really a problem. So on the one hand, you can see that these attributes are impressive, but at the same time, these attributes pose some serious problems. And then we looked at some what we call metaphysical attributes, simplicity and so on, immutability. And finally, among the metaphysical attributes, we have impassibility. This means that God is not affected by anything. Although God created, sustains, and governs the world, God is not affected by anything in the world. The world depends on God, but for its existence, but God does not depend on the world. So, you know, this idea that God is not affected by, although God created in any manner, God can't be affected, influenced by what is happening in the world or the nature of the world. It is something like that, you know, God just created it. And then, you know, but the you know, this idea has been not only for Christianity or those theistic religions, even in Hinduism. In Hinduism, they say that the creation of the world is Leela. Leela means Krida. Krida means sport. So God created world for sport, for fun, you know, something like that, you know. Well, which means that, you know, God is not really in that sense responsible. But on the other hand, you can see here, God created, God sustains, and God governs the world. So on the one hand, you have these characteristics, but on the other hand, you want to say that God is not affected by that. But how can you really maintain these two positions? It's really an important question. So we will look a little bit further into this. This attribute is in tension with the biblical God. This attribute is in tension with the biblical God, who not only acts on the people he created, but also is affected by their distress, becoming angry upon their sinning, taking pity on them in their misery, etc. Now, if you take the biblical concept of God, the concept of God in the Bible, you can see that these attributes are, contradicting some of these natures of God in the Bible. I think I told you again, these characteristics of God were developed by theologians subsequently. But if you look at Bible, particularly the Old Testament Bible, you can see that in the Old Testament Bible, God not only created the world, he was looking after the world. He gets angry when people are not behaving well. So if he gets angry when people don't behave well, that means God is affected by what he created, right? And then he feels bad, when they undergo suffering. So, this whole issue is a very interesting thing. If you take the biblical concept of God, the God in the Bible is a different God. I said to you at the very beginning, he is described as a jealous God. Jealous God in the sense, he doesn't want those who believe in him to believe in any other God. So, he is a jealous God. He is an angry God. He curses and, all types of things. So, there is within the same religious tradition, in the Bible, the God is depicted in one manner, but in the philosophy, in theology, God has been attributed with these characteristics. So there is a tension here, there is a difficulty here. Now another difficulty is that if God is impassible, how can he be compassionate and merciful? Being compassionate implies that God is moved by the misery of the world. Now, there's another interesting thing. Now, another argument presented is, how can God be compassionate? Compassionate means that he is also affected by misery of the people. Then I put this within parentheses, I put the question, does the Buddha's Mahakaruna mean that the Buddha is affected by the miseries of the world? Now, what do you think about that? Okay, if we say that God is affected by miseries of the world, now Buddha has Mahakaruna, right? Mahakaruna and Mahapanya. So, does that mean that Buddha is affected by the miseries of the world? What do I mean by this is this? Does that mean that when somebody is really in suffering, Buddha also becomes emotionally upset, sorrowful? Does Buddha feel bad about it? What do you think? Now we say that Buddha has Mahakaruna, but can he be with Mahakaruna without getting moved by? How do you see this? On the one hand, about God, we say there is argument, God can't be compassionate if he is merciful. That means he is moved by misery. He is moved by misery. That means, he is emotionally, reacting. But if we accept this argument, then the problem is, can we say the same thing about the Buddha? Now, Buddha has Mahakaruna. Will Buddha cry? Can Buddha and Arahant cry? Yes or no? Huh? You remember the couple of years ago, there was a very interesting incident. There was this very well-known Thai Buddhist monk who was considered to be Arahant, Venerable Mahabhuva. Have you heard about him? Venerable Mahabhuva, B-O-O-V-E. You can see in Google. Now, giving an interview, at some point he cried. And then there was a serious problem whether Venerable Mahabhuva is an Arahant or not, because up to that point people believe that he is an Arahant. But will an Arahant cry out of compassion, kindness? Will an Arahant cry? What do you think? Why do we cry at all anyway? When we have certain emotions, right? Unbearable emotions, you know, when we have certain emotions, people cry, right? Isn't it? So can an arahant have that kind of emotions? Sometimes people cry out of happiness, you know, when you are watching a football match, you know, your preferred side, you know, wins a goal, then, you know, sometimes people cry because, you know, cry in the sense, you know, they are so happy. Or sometimes people cry because they are so unhappy. But can that happen to an arahant? Okay, I will leave that for you to think. I am not going to answer. But anyhow, if we believe that arahant can cry, Buddha can also cry. But if you don't believe that arahant cannot cry, then Buddha cannot also cry. But on the other hand, we believe that Buddha was compassionate, right? Buddha had Mahakaruna. Yes. Do we have a doubt about that? No. But then, you know, the interesting thing is, you know, how do we define the Mahakaruna? Now, in the Buddha's case, although we say compassionate, the compassion was... there is one famous stanza, Vadhake deva dattamhi chore angulimalake rahule chapi sabbath samamanasu. Do you know that? Give me the missing word. I miss one word. Vadhake deva dattamhi chore angulimalake dhanapale rahule chapi sabbath samamanasu. Now, Buddha had sabbatha samamanaso. What is the meaning of that? Come on. I mean, you folks know Pali, right? Sabbatha samamanaso. Buddha's mind was samamanaso. Equal mind. Padake devadattamhi. Devadatta, who came to kill him. Padake deva chore angulimalake, or nangulimala. Dhanapali, the elephant who came to kill him. Rahula. Who is that? His own son. Sabbatha samamanaso. Buddha's mind was. So you can see that if we go by that, Buddha is not moved. Buddha is not really taken emotionally. Because Buddha's mind to Rahula and Buddha's mind to Devadatta is the same. So that means he is not emotional. But on the other hand, at the same time, he is helping both Dhanapali, Devadatta and Rahula, right? Anyway, folks, I want you to think about it. Because, I mean, about God, the argument is God cannot be compassionate and merciful unless he is moved. But my question about the Buddha is, we also say that Buddha is compassionate. But does somebody have to be moved in order to be compassionate? Or can anyone be compassionate without getting emotionally moved? And these are open questions, you know, for you to think. You'll have to find your own answers, okay? I'm not going to give answers. I mean, I don't have answers anyway. Okay, the God's personhood is essential for theism. If God is not a person, how can he do all things he is said to have done? But not only impassibility, but also the rest of the metaphysical attributes become problematic to God's personhood. Now, what is the God's personhood? Again, in the biblical story, God is a person. God is a person. God is, you know, one person. Now, he does things. However, if you take these metaphysical attributes like simplicity, you know, there were four metaphysical attributes we discussed. Eternity, God is eternal, immutability, unchanging, impassibility, simplicity. God is simple, there are no parts, there are no limbs. So simple, and then timeless, eternal. And then earlier we had omnipresent, everywhere, immutability, doesn't undergo change, then finally impassibility. God is not moved by anything. We say that, so the problem is, God's personhood is essential for theism. That means theism, believe in God, God as a person is very important, particularly in the biblical God is a person. Now, but on the other hand, if you attribute this simplicity, immutability, infinity, and impassibility, God can't be a person. So on the one hand, you can see God is a person. On the other hand, you can see that God is not a person, okay? I'm just showing to you some of these. Okay, look at this quotation. Why think that the metaphysical attributes are perfections? For several reasons. Most religious traditions stress the imperfections of the temporal order. The space-time world is a world is in constant flux. Nothing in it is permanent or secure. All temporal values are threatened and ultimately lost. In human experience, complexity, time, change, and dependency are bound up with loss and imperfection. It thus isn't surprising that religiously sensitive people often conclude that maximally perfect reality must be free from them. Now, this is from the Concept of God, Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy. This explains why these metaphysical attributes are perfections. Whole point is, according to Christian theological point of view, if you put God in the temporal and spatial order, particularly the temporal order, in the order of time, within time things are changing. Changing means like we are born, we become young, and then we become old, which is not very good, okay? We have things, they are okay for some time, and then they decay, and then finally disintegrate. So within time, things are changing, but changing means usually changing can be for better or for worse. But very often when we think about the peoples and things, changing means you become gradually going towards the death, right? So changing is not good. So anything within temporal order, within time, and within space is not good. So the metaphysical attribute means God doesn't have a place, a space. Now, if I have a physical body, God has a physical body like me and you, then God occupies a space. But God is not occupying a space. God is spaceless. Or we say that He is omnipresent everywhere, all the time. Now you see, this is the philosophical concept of God. Now philosophical concept of God means it is not a person they are talking about. They are talking about some kind of universal principle, some universal reality, not really a person as such, okay? All right, I will wind up this part of discussion today and then I will move into new discussion after this. But to summarize what I discussed so far, actually the attributes of God, so we had major attributes like omniscient, all-knowing, omnipotent, all-powerful, and then all-good, good in every manner. So these are the main things, and then we have what is called metaphysical. But you need to understand this, really, we are having the traditional biblical concept of God. And also we have the concept of God as a universal principle. Now the second thing is really a philosophically, theologically created concept of God. Because when you talk about the God as a person, you know, there are a lot of problems. You know, particularly, God has been interpreted as a universal principle coming out from this personal concept of God. Okay, but beginning of discussion, I said to you, when we are dealing with, when we are trying to understand, when we live with people belonging to Christianity, I mean Judaism, Christianity and Islam, and also people with Hinduism. Now the understanding concept of God is very, very important. Okay, so when people call God, actually what do they mean is something very interesting. Very often for ordinary people in all these religions, God is a person. Somebody compassionate, living in the heaven. And then the idea is that one day you will be born in heaven, and then that is the last birth, you will be forever in heaven. Now this is a pretty basic, simple idea, okay? This is what they mean. However, if you look at the theological literature, philosophical literature, and if you talk to a educated person on this matter, then you know by God they are meaning not really a personal God. They are meaning a universal type of principle. Now this is the same with Hinduism also. I explained to you Hinduism started with polytheism, henotheism, and then monotheistic type one God. Now even today people believe in Vishnu, Shaiva, Shiva. But then at the same time, if you take Advaita Vedanta, another very developed branch of Hinduism today, of course it also Advaita comes from Vedanta comes from Upanishadic philosophy. Now Advaita Vedanta believes that Brahman is not a person. Brahman is a principle, like this concept of God. So in other words, what I am trying to tell you is there are two different concepts, not different, but you know, one is a more philosopher's idea of God, the other is the ordinary person's idea of God. Okay, so ordinary person's idea of God in Judaism, Christianity, you read Bible, then you see who the God is, what is he doing, and you know, things like that. Or you read Quran, or you read Vaishnava and Shaiva literature, you look at God as a person. And then when I was discussing with you the path to a goal, when you are believing in a personal God, of course the love, faith is the main thing. That is the same with theistic religions in Western tradition or theistic religions in the Hindu tradition, Vaishnava and Shaiva. They have a huge literature on expressing love and devotion for Vishnu or Shiva. So devotional songs are very popular in India, as some of you know, because devotion for the personal God. But you know, when you have the God as like simple, immutable, impassible phenomenon, then you know he can't be listening to your thing because he doesn't have an ear. He can't be seeing you because God doesn't have eyes. God is not a person. God doesn't occupy a space. Okay, so this is basically the two ways the concept of God has been described. Okay, now the next I am going to move into the discussion on how to prove the existence of God, you know, how they have tried. But before moving to it, have you got any, I mean, some idea about what I have been talking to you up to this point? Do you have any questions about it? Are you at least somewhat clear about it? Now here I try to explain why these so-called metaphysical perfections are qualities are perfections, because if you put God in a space and time thing, God becomes a changing thing. But when you say simple, immutable, eternal, then we are not talking about the person. We are talking about, you know, different things. So in the traditional religion, if you don't talk about the person, then no meaning of God, because God has to be a person. But on the other hand, philosophical and theological conception, God is not a person. Any ideas? Any questions or anything? So what do we think? Hmm? Okay, no questions, no comments. Let me see. Okay, another important area when we discuss world religions, particularly the religions based on God, where is it? Okay. In discussing religions, particularly the theistic religions, God-centered religions, one very important thing is to prove the existence of God. The most fundamental assumption of theism is that God is real. Since the entire religious system depends on this, theologians and philosophers have produced many arguments to prove that God really exists, or that God is a reality and not a fabrication. Now, you know, in the God-centered religion, something very, very important and also philosophically interesting is to prove that there is somebody called God. In other words, to prove that God really exists. This is very interesting because this is the belief in God, this is the fundamental basic belief in theism. But although it is the fundamental basic belief, how did people come to believe that there is someone called God? Now, how do we believe this? Where is God? Now, if you take a traditional concept of God, Bible, or in Quran, or in other Hindu literature, God is in heaven. In Christian language, we say kingdom of God. So, God is the ruler, king, and then God has a kingdom. Like any other king has a kingdom, God has a kingdom. So, God is in his kingdom of God, or heaven, right? Now, which means that there is somebody called God. But then the problem is, how do we know really whether there is really a person called God? How do we know that? People believe it so much. But if you ask, how do you know that God exists? You know, it has been a major issue for theistic religions to prove that God exists, to prove that what you believe is the person is there. So people have come up with different kinds of arguments. Now, if you look at Buddhism or Jainism, this problem is not for those religions, even for Advaita Vedanta, because they do not believe in a personal God, okay? So they don't believe in like that. But then here the important thing is you have to prove that a person called God exists. But then even if you don't believe the personal God, suppose we are looking at the philosophical God, like with these characteristics, simplicity and all that. But still then, how do we know that that type of principle, universal principle, unchanging, eternal thing is there? How do we know that? So, existence of God, to prove that God exists, has been a really important issue in theology. In any religious traditions, theistic religious traditions. Last discussion I told you about the encounter between Abraham and God. So the belief is that the people had many beliefs in many gods, but this, you know, this particular God and Abraham had an agreement. So which means that we are talking about two people talking and two people get into an agreement, right? And then this God promises Abraham that he will protect Abraham and his people. So you can, pretty simple. Now, it is mentioned in the Bible. So if you just go by the book, yeah, Bible says that there is a person called God. Bible says that, you know, God will protect Abraham and people. But, you know, when you look at the history, actually, in one of the discussions, I really wanted to discuss the history of God with you. So the God starting like that, but after several centuries, when it came to Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ said that he is the Son of God. And he referred to Father in the heaven. So the Father is in the heaven, he is the Son. So, you know, in the Christian belief, they take all these stories to be real. So for a believer in theistic religion, yeah, you look at the Bible, you look at the Quran, you know, so the God exists. You know, we are talking about as if a person. But in spite of this, not only for, even for Christians and also others, there is an issue, how do we know? Apart from the book, apart from the religious book, how do we know? Now, you know, this religious literature is something very interesting. According to theistic traditions, religious literature is something revealed. Revealed literature. Revealed means God reveals it. So we have to believe that Bible is not somebody, has not been written by somebody. It has been revealed. And the best example is Quran. Quran is not Muhammad. Quran is believed to be the what God revealed to Muhammad. So actually in the Islamic tradition, Muhammad is not considered to be sacred or anything. Because, you know, it was, Muhammad is only a mouthpiece. Muhammad was used by God in order to give this. But okay, that is the religious belief. But on the other hand, if you don't believe that story, then the question is, who is the author of Quran? If God did not reveal it, if you don't believe that God did not reveal, God revealed it, then we have to think, who is the author? Now, the funny thing is this, when you say God revealed it, you can't have an author. So in the tradition, there is no name for the author. It is something like our Abhidharma. Abhidharma, we say, Buddha taught Abhidharma to gods. So Abhidharma Pitaka doesn't have an author. It would be very nice, you know, if the authors were mentioned. But there is no author, because logically you can't have an author if you believe that Buddha taught Abhidhamma. So Buddha is the author. So no any other author. But anyhow, somewhat like that. So in these theistic religions, no author, because it comes from God. You know, so this is really an issue. Now, other people will not believe that God exists. So there must be proofs to prove that God exists. God exists. Now, within the Christian tradition itself, there have been a lot of problems. Again, I ask you to read Bible, right? I don't know how many people started reading Bible. But in Bible, there's another very important chapter called Jobs. The name of the chapter is Jobs. Job, J-O-B-S, Jobs. Now, I mean, this person called Job, it's a very interesting incident. Now, Job is a person who believes in God so much, okay? And then he does everything correctly. He doesn't do anything wrong, okay? I mean, he is such a good person, according to the story. However, in Job's life, all the bad things happen to Job. His crops are devastated, his children get sick, and, you know, people die. And, you know, nothing goes right for Job. Everything goes wrong for Job. But on the other hand, he is so good, believes in God so much. You read that chapter, that's a very fascinating chapter. The question is, then Job asked, God, why is this? Why is this happening to me only? Where are you? And look at all these bad people. Everything is fine for them. But I am a good person, but nothing is good for me. Nothing is fine for me. Everything is going wrong with me. Why? Now, you know, in this biblical book, Jobs, there is no answer to this question. There is no answer to this question. The chapter ends without answer. I mean, this is really the problem of evil. I referred to you just about the other section of this discussion, right? Because if you believe that, you know, God is all merciful, kind, omniscient, omnipotent, why does everything bad is happening to Job? Why can't he do something about it? I mean, this is really a very, very interesting issue, that problem of evil. You know, we call it problem of evil. Problem of evil is really the existence of evil in the world. So how can it be God creating a world, you know, such a world? So this chapter in Bible, the story of, you know, Job's. So the issue is, again, the problem of evil. Now, how can you explain everything goes wrong to Job's, although he is such a good person, you know? So this problem. Now, in the face of this kind of problems, it becomes very important even for the so-called believers of theistic religions to have some proofs about the existence of God. So historically, we have many scholarly arguments to prove that God is not only a name, but God really exists, okay? So in this discussion, I'm going to discuss with you several arguments historically presented by Christian theologians in order to prove that God really exists. Now, the first argument I would like to discuss with you is called the ontological argument for the existence of God. The ontological argument. Now, what is the meaning of ontology? Ontology means, basically the meaning of the term is the study of the study of existence, ontology, study of existence. So the ontological argument, now ontology is a part of philosophy. When you study philosophy, you come across this term. This is a study of the existence of things. This is the study of the being, B-E-I-N-G, being of things, existence of things. So the ontological argument. This argument was first presented by Saint Anselm, the Catholic Archbishop of Canterbury. Actually, he lived in the 11th century, so long time ago, more than 1,000 years ago. During that time in England, not only in England, there was no Protestantism, only Roman Catholic religion. So the Canterbury means the main church in England even today, but of course now it is not Roman Catholic, you know, it is Anglican. But so the Saint Anselm is the Catholic Archbishop of Canterbury. It's a purely logical argument based on reasoning, not appealing to any facts. This ontological argument is a logical argument. Logic means like mathematics, it doesn't refer to anything in the world. It does not refer to any fact. Like if you take mathematics, when we say 2 plus 2 equals 4, 2 can be anything. We don't know 2, but we also don't want to know 2. Like all the numbers are like logical. They don't refer to any particular objects, tables or chairs or anything like that. In the same manner, logical argument means the argument purely based on logic, okay? Reasoning, nothing to do with the existence of other things. So this is a very fascinating argument. It is a purely logical argument based on reasoning, not appealing to any facts. When we say that God exists, what we mean by this is that a perfect being exists. We have an idea of a perfect being in our mind. But for a perfect being, it is better to exist in reality, because if he does not exist in reality, he cannot be a perfect being. Now, this is a little bit complicated argument, but we will try to follow it. So, let me. If it is true that we can have a concept of perfect being in our mind, then we have to admit that really existing perfect being is more perfect than conceptual perfect being. Since there cannot be a more perfect being, the perfect being who exists must be the perfect being. In other words, this is to say that God is the perfect being, and perfection included existence, and therefore God exists. To say that God does not exist is to contradict oneself. The perfect being who exists does not exist. Now, try to follow this argument basically. Why do we call this a logical argument? You interpret, you define God as the perfect being. Okay, it's something like this. So first you define God equals God equals perfect being. Now when you say God is a perfect being, perfect being, perfect, that means he is not deficient in anything. Now when we say God is perfect, he must have all perfections. So it means that when we say God is perfect being, we say that something like this: God must have all perfections. And then we say existence is a perfection. Okay? Then we say if existence is a perfection, and if God is perfect, then he must have existence. Therefore, God exists. So our conclusion is God exists. Therefore, God exists. What do you think? I mean, simply look at this as argument. Are you convinced by this argument that God exists? First, try to understand this argument. First, try to understand this argument. Now, when we say an argument, you know what argument means, right? Argument has premises and conclusion. Okay, argument is something that have premises, and also argument has a conclusion. Now if you look at this, all these things we can say up to this point, these are premises, and then this is conclusion. So argument has premises and a conclusion, or several conclusions. Premises means what we say in order to prove that argument, in order to prove the conclusion. So actually argument is basically that. Do you see that? So when we say argument, in English language, argument has a bad meaning. When I get into argument with somebody, that means dispute. But here it is not that. This is a philosophical meaning of argument. Argument means something with premises and a conclusion, right? Premises means reasons to prove our conclusion. Now in this argument, what is the conclusion? God exists. God exists is the conclusion. In order to prove that conclusion, we give some set of reasons. What are the set of reasons? Number one says, God must have all perfections. Because we start by defining God as a perfect being. We say God is a perfect being. Now, if we say God is perfect being, then God must have all perfections. Then next one says, existence is a perfection. Okay? Next one says, if existence is a perfection, and if God is perfect, then God must have existence. Then we conclude, therefore God exists. Now you see, in order to prove that God exists, why this is called a logical argument? We don't go anywhere beyond logical reasoning, okay? We just start with the defining God in such a way, and through that definition, we try to prove that God exists. Okay, this is, of course, this Anselm's argument can be formulated in many different ways, but this is the one simple way to formulate Anselm's argument. What do you think about argument? Now, when you read this argument, are you going to believe that, yeah, surely God exists? Do you agree with this conclusion or not? Now, what is the situation? Okay, this is the argument. Tell me what is, there are two possibilities. Either you must now accept that there is really God exists. But if you don't accept, that means this argument is no good. Tell me what is not good in this argument. Why you don't accept this argument, if you don't accept? If you don't accept, why you don't accept this argument? Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. But we can say that he is really perfect. But mm-hmm. here, God, so I disagree.
Okay, yeah. But for that, I can say following. Now, Buddha, we know that Buddha lived and Buddha passed away. Okay? But Buddha once lived. So we don't have any argument about Buddha's existence because we know that Buddha, as a historical person, lived in India. So there is no doubt about that. Now Buddha is no more. But now we can't say Buddha is perfect. We can say Buddha was perfect, really. So, you know, you are trying to compare really a living Buddha who was a historical figure. I don't think you can compare here Buddha with God. Because Buddha really historical person. He lived in India. And he died in India after 80 years. Okay? Of course, we say Buddha is perfect, but Buddha is perfect when he was living. Now the perfect Buddha has attained Parinirvana. So, yeah, it's different because, you know, I don't think we can really use the concept of Buddha to here because he is a historical person. But there are ways to counter this argument. If you are not convinced, why? Tell me. Now you must accept that God exists if this is a good argument. If not, why? Simply because you are Buddhist, you don't want to believe in God, or something wrong with. Now she came up with one objection. Of course, I had answer to that, but like that. What do you think about this argument? Why this argument doesn't work? Why do you think that this argument is not successful? Either you must accept that God exists based on this argument, or if you don't accept God is existing, then why? What are the things that you will not agree here? Okay, without wasting much time, let me show you a couple of things. Now, when we take this argument, one thing is here. First, we start by saying God is a perfect being. God equals perfect. Now, you know, who gives this definition? We give this definition. We say that God is perfect. You know, the interesting thing is, Can you really define something in a manner you want and then attribute things to that person or whatever? Because defining is something we do. We do by ourselves. So we define does not mean that everything we attribute to it exists really. So, you know, when we say God equals perfect being, that is how we define it. But our definitions are also arbitrary because we define it the way we want. Okay, we say that God is perfect. So defining itself is problematic. And then the next thing is, okay, when we say God is perfect, we say God must have all perfections. Okay, if God is perfect, we can say that yes, God has to have all perfections. If God is the, we don't know, but for the sake of argument, if we say that God is perfect, then God must have all perfections. Now what about this thing? Do you agree with this? Existence is a perfection? Is that true? Existence is a perfection? Come on, give me a Buddhist point of view of existence. According to Buddhism, I mean, because that is what you know. That's how you criticize the argument. Now, from what you know, you tell me whether existence is a perfection. What do you think? Yes? Okay, but actually the way I would like to take you is not that way. Now, according to Buddhism, can we say that existence is a perfection? Why not? According to Buddhism, can we say existence is a perfection?
I mean, existence for the present.
Yeah, I mean, exist means living. You can say living. We live, we exist, right? All of us exist now. Is it perfect? Put it that way. Existence means God exists means God lives. I exist means I live. So what is the Buddhist point of view? According to Buddhism, can we say existence or living in the world or living in some form, is it perfect? Yes or no? Give me reasons.
No.
Yeah, why do you say no? Very good. Very good. Why do you say no?
If someone has existence as a form, if so, somewhat a part of then we can somebody dislike or to change another part. That is why all existence are not perfection. Some more existence are not perfection.
I mean, give some more. I mean, clearer response. Okay, very good. You say existence is not perfect, but your reasoning is not very clear. But can somebody come up with another reason why existence is not perfect, if you think it is not perfect? I mean, come on, come from the Buddhist point of view. You know so much about it. Come. I don't know why you don't come out. Why do you say, okay, existence is not perfect? Why? Come on, it's pretty simple in that sense.
Okay. There are many examples we can say existence is not perfection because we can give many examples about the...
Reverend, okay. Now, don't really bog down this word perfection. Now, simply if you look at existence, like look at the human existence. Look at human existence. We don't talk, want about... if you say existence is perfection, you can ask, according to Buddhism, existence is jati pi dukkha, jara pi dukkha, vyadha pi dukkha, maranam pi dukkhaṁ, appiyehi sampayogo dukkho, piyehi vipayogo dukkho, yam piccha nalavadi tam pi dukkhaṁ. Now, what do you think? Is existence is a perfection according to Buddhism? Then we say, Buddha says, kama, tanha, bhava tanha, vibhava tanha. Now, if even if you exist in the kama world, or if you exist in the rupa world, even if you exist in the arupa world, existence is what? Dukkham. Okay. Right? Now, you know, no, this is how you should look at it. Now, when you see this, existence is a perfection. Now, perfection means, Reverend, something best. Nothing better than that. Now, if you say existence is perfection, existence is so good, now, because what you know is better know is Buddhism, you can say, no, from a Buddhist point of view, this is wrong. At least from what you know, you can come up with a counter argument. When somebody says existence is perfection, you can say no. I mean, you can exist as a person who doesn't have one hand, person who doesn't have both hands, person whose eyes are not good, as a person you can't hear. There are so many disabled persons in the world, right? Is that perfect? Is that perfect? No, it is not perfect. So can we say that existence is a perfection? At least according to Buddhism, we can say, no, existence is not a perfection. Of course, all of us exist. Not only human beings. If you look at this world, so many animals exist. Mosquitoes exist. You don't like them at all, right? So you don't like that. There are so many things that exist in the world. So you can really say that existence is a perfection. You know, it's not a perfection, okay? Now, the other thing, if existence is a perfection, and if God is perfect, then he must have existence. Yes, this is logically we can say true. If existence is a perfection, if God is perfect, then we can say he has to have existence. Then also we can conclude, if all the premises are true, then we can say, yes, God exists. But the problem is, existence is a perfection is problematic. And also, when we say, God must have all perfections, because problem is here. We start with, God has to have all perfections. Now, why this? What is this argument for? In order to prove that God exists. But we start saying that God has all perfections. So in other words, logically, you have already assumed what you want to prove. Now that is a very big problem. Do you understand what I'm saying? When we say God has all perfections, we want to prove that God is real. But in order to prove God is real, in our very first one, we say God must have all perfections. We already assume that God exists. You know, we assume it. Otherwise, how can we talk God? When we say God must have all perfections, I mean, that is what we are trying to prove here. We don't know whether God exists. But the argument begins with, God has all perfections. You know, because it's really a serious logical problem, because what you want to prove, you already assume. Okay? Now that is a big logical problem. You already assume what you want to prove. Sometimes, you know, we don't understand. I will give you a simple example. If I ask from you, have you stopped smoking? What is your answer? Yes? Have you stopped smoking? Have you stopped smoking? Yes or no?
No.
No. That means you smoked before, right?
No.
Yeah, still, you still, you still smoke, okay. What is the answer? Have you stopped smoking?
Is it
both?
Could be both, yes or no?
Yeah, if you say yes, that means you smoked before, right? Uh-huh. If you say no,
it may continue.
Yeah, anyway, my question, I assume that you are smoking. That's why my question, right? So when I ask from you, have you stopped smoking? I assume that you smoke already. But my question is, have you stopped it? So actually, when I ask one question, have you stopped smoking, there are two sentences in that. What are the two sentences? Number one, you smoke. Number two, have you stopped? But But my question comes in one sentence, have you stopped smoking? But if you analyze that sentence, this is pretty simple. You have two things there. One is you are smoking. Number two is, have you stopped that? But if you are a person who have never started smoking, you can't answer that question. You can't answer that question. So my assumption is wrong. When I ask you, have you stopped smoking? That's a wrong question. Like that, you look at this. When we say God must have all perfections, we are already assuming that God exists. But on the other hand, what we are trying to do is to prove the existence of God. So in order to prove the existence of God, we are given an argument. In that argument, we are really assuming the existence of God, right? You know, that is a really a logical problem. No, you know, you really have to see this. Now, when you read something, you have to really analyze it. You must really learn to analyze something. Analyze a logical argument, okay? It is not only memorizing, but you look at what is on the chalkboard and you must be able to analyze it and see. Okay, now, this is what is called ontological argument for the existence of God. So the argument was presented in the 10th century long time ago by a Christian clergy, and he thought that from this logical argument you can prove that there is some person called God exists. But logically the problem is, how can you define God as a perfect being? Okay, we say that for the time being you can design, but the thing is, then how do you really say that existence is a perfection? And this says that to exist is good. Now look at this. When we say God exists, we mean by this that a perfect being exists. And we have an idea of perfect being in our mind. Now when we talk about the perfect being exists, we have an idea about perfect being in our mind. So the argument says, but for a perfect being, it is better to exist in reality. Rather than having an idea in our mind, if that person exists in reality, then that is better. Because if he does not exist in reality, he cannot be a perfect being. Okay? When you define God as a perfect being, then we say that to exist is better, or still better perfection. So therefore, if the perfect being, he must have the most perfect characteristics, namely the existence. Okay, I mean, various different ways, but of course it is a way to try to prove the existence of God by okay, if it is true that we have a concept of perfect being in our mind, then we have to admit that really existing perfect being is more perfect than conceptual perfect being. Okay, you can have about the God, you can have an idea in your mind. So if you can have an idea in your mind, you can say that there is an idea of existing God in my mind. Then you can say that if that God really exists, that is better. Okay, that's what it means. Since there cannot be a more perfect being, the perfect being who exists must be the perfect being, that is only. In other words, this is to say that God is the perfect being and perfection included existence, and therefore God exists. So this is the argument. To say that God does not exist is to contradict oneself. The perfect being who exists does not exist. Now if you say the perfect being does not exist, they say that it is a self-contradictory statement. Because the moment you say perfect being, according to this argument, you accept that that person exists. So if you say perfect being does not exist, it is a problem. How can perfect being does not exist? Because by definition, perfect being is the person who is really existing. So you see, this argument has been now more than 1,000 years, but people are still kind of debating about this. Interesting thing is, you start from a definition and then you attribute existence to it. from that. You start from definition. But, you know, simply, in other words, it shows that you cannot really attribute the existence biologically. Let me give you an example. I say this pen is red. Now, when I say this pen is red, do I have to say that this pen exists and it is red? No. When I talk about this pen, we know that it is real. Okay? The moment I talk about this pen exists, you don't ask whether the pen exists or not. When I say this pen is red, you don't ask whether the pen is existing or not. You simply know whether it is red or not. Now, can we say the same thing? Now, if we say God is omniscient, when we say God is omniscient, like the pen is red. Now, the funny thing is this. When I say pen is red, if you look at the two sentences, both sentences have the same structure. Pen is red, God is perfect. Two sentences are the same, same structure. But when we say pen is red, we know what we are talking about. But when I say God is perfect, then the problem is you ask, who is God? Now you don't ask, what is pen? Because you know that pen is there. Now you see, we can talk about anything that we create in our mind. We can say, okay, God, God is good, God is perfect, God is this, God is that. But the issue is, the moment you say God is perfect, you assume that God exists. But how do you know that? So, saying a sentence about something doesn't mean that it exists. But here the interesting thing in this argument is, you say God is the perfect being. And then you say, when you say perfect being, you include existence into perfect. So moment you say God is perfect, you also say that God exists. So logically, if you accept that definition, then you can argue that God exists or God should exist. But still then the problem is that somebody needs to prove really that God exists. So by logically, by way of defining, you know, you give a definition first. But then definitions are given by us. I mean, how can we give that definition? What is the right we have to give that definition? You define the perfection. Now, that is why I say, when they say that, okay, existence is a perfection, you can ask from a Buddhist point of view, no, existence is not a perfection. Existence is dukkha, right? So, you know, there are ways to counter that argument, okay? Now, why I am presenting this argument is, you can see that, you know, the existence of God has been debated over 2000 years by people from many, many different points of view. Now, this is ontological argument for the existence of God is one of very well known in the Western tradition. So, in other words, ontological argument means you prove the existence of God by the idea of existence of the perfect being. So you define God as a perfect being and then include existence in that, and then you say God exists. Okay. Now, you know, there are different types of, you know, the criticisms about it. Now, if this argument is true, then you must all accept that God exists. But, you know, we know that this argument is challenging, because particularly if something is really existing somewhere, that you cannot prove logically, that you have to prove empirically. Empirically means through experience. You show, look, that is God over there sitting, something like that. Then you prove it. And then you say that God is good, that God is, you know, this and this and that. But without doing that, you just attribute thing to this concept God, but concept doesn't mean it is only in your mind. In our mind, we can have a concept of anything and everything except logically contradicting things. You remember one of my earlier discussions, I said we cannot have a concept of a square circle. Because by definition, you can't have a concept of a square circle. But you can have a concept of a person with 1,000 hands. Although a person with 1,000 hands doesn't exist, you can imagine. But a square circle, you can't even imagine, right? Because that's logically impossible. But person with 1,000 hands, you can imagine. You can imagine a person with 2 hands. You can imagine then 4 hands, 8 hands, 16 hands, 32 hands, 64 hands. You can imagine, no problem. But does that mean that such a person exists? No. We can imagine. Right? We can imagine because it's a logically possible concept. But we can't prove that. Because proving the existence is something different. Proving the existence is something different. Every time I say this pen is red, I assume that this pen means something really existing. But then God is omniscient, you assume God is there. But how do you know? Pen, I can say, look, touch. You can see pen exist. Yeah. But how can you prove the existence of God? Simply by argument. You know, this logical thing is something very, very interesting. Now, for example, I say God does not exist. I say God does not exist. Then you can ask a question from me, who does not exist? Then my answer is God. Isn't it funny? I say God doesn't exist. Okay? I say God doesn't exist. But then you ask, who does not exist? Then my answer is God. Then what? Look at this. I say God does not exist. Then you ask, who does not exist? Answer, God. Now what? I say God doesn't exist. You can ask, who doesn't exist? I have to answer, God. Now you see, the funny thing is here this. Now on the one hand, you can say that moment I say that God doesn't exist, I talk something about something or some person or somebody or some concept called God. But here, when I say God doesn't exist, what I am saying is really that there is such a concept called God, but there is no person who is God. That's what I am saying. But on the other hand, even if person is not there, we can talk about concept. So when we say God doesn't exist, what I really mean is something that is called God does not really exist. Right? That's what I mean. When I say God doesn't exist, what I really mean by that is something that is called God does not exist. Okay? So if you really analyze this sentence, you can see that what I mean by that. Anyway, I just wanted to, wake up your memory, logical reasoning. I know this is not the best time for this thing because right after your midday meal. But, when you look at this kind of argument, you look at the argument and see what is wrong with the argument, okay? Now, whole thing about learning is actually we give arguments in order to prove what we mean. But then you can look at the premises, whether these premises really support the conclusion, whether you can get the conclusion from these premises, right? Earlier I wrote the argument, premises, and then the conclusion is God exists. Can we really know that God exists through these premises? Now here the important thing is the argument is what is called ontological argument, trying to prove the existence of God through logical reasoning, okay, without anything. Important thing is, you know, the existence is not a logical quality. Existence means something exists, something is real. You can't prove it logically. You really have to prove it empirically. Empirically means you have to see it, you have to touch it, you have to know it. Then only you can prove, right? Here what has happened is, try to prove the existence of God by defining God as an existing being. Now logically, now I also showed you, when you say God is perfect, you assume what you want to prove. So in logically we call this is a circular argument. You go round and round the same thing. Okay? So logically this argument is wrong. This wrong argument is called circular argument. Circular argument is, you know, you go by the same thing circular. You start with God and then finally come to God. Okay? When you look at the argument, you can see that it is circular because it assumes what you want to prove. So in logical language, we call it circular argument. And also we use another word for this, begging the question. In Western logical reasoning, we say begging the question. And also Eastern Indian logic also we use a similar term for this. In other words, what it means is, we say, it's something like this. We say, God is perfect. Perfect being has existence, then conclusion, therefore God exists. Now this is your conclusion, this is what you want to prove. These are your premises. But, you know, interesting thing is here, simple way to show that this is wrong. What do you want to prove? God exists. But then how do you start? What you want to prove, you have already accepted. Okay? This is what you want to prove, you have already accepted. It is something like, why it is called circular argument? It's like this, God. Okay? So, it's something like this, you know? We come from here to there. So, the God, we start from God and we come back to God. So, this is a circular argument. God is perfect. And then, therefore, God exists. You want to prove God exists, but you already assume that God exists. Because how can you say that God is perfect unless you believe that it exists? How can I say that this pen is red unless I believe that it is real? Right? Do you see the logical problem here? Okay? So anyhow, I'm not really sure whether I'm successful in showing you this, but this is really a very interesting argument in the Christian theological thinking. More than 1,000 years old, the argument is that, you know, you prove the existence of God by defining God as an existing being. So why it is logically wrong, logically unsatisfactory is, you know, you have to really examine it very carefully, okay? So, I will not proceed from there anymore. Many philosophers have commented on this argument. Immanuel Kant's criticism is well known. He rejected it by showing that existence is not an attribute like any other. He said, one cannot add currency notes to an imaginary currency notes. So if you have an imaginary currency note, you cannot add real currency notes to it, because the first one is imaginary. First one doesn't exist. In other words, what Kant said is, existence is not an attribute. We look at the attribute. We say God is good. God is all-knowing. God is all-perfect. But in all sentences, we talk about God as if God is existing. So, if you want to prove the existence of God, you have to do that separately. You see the difference? The moment we say God is perfect, like pen is red, we assume already that God exists. So, we can have any number of adjectives. God is God, God is good, God is tall, God has a long beard, and you know, whatever, all these things you can say. But God is real, God is true, God really exists. You can't add like that. Try. Yes.
When I go back in my village, I had this lots of friends in Christian
village. Yeah. God is?
God is perfect.
Perfect, yes. Yeah.
God is perfect. Existence is perfect.
Yeah.
God is. God has any way. So at the time I asked a question, my friends. So which way? What is perfect God? What is existence God? Just now you explained me God has any way. Which way?
Right.
So, I think there are different religions, different ways.
Yeah. So, thank you. Yeah, actually, it's true that your friends can say God is perfect.
Yes.
But then the point is from this argument is, Venerable, when God is perfect, the moment you say God is perfect, you already assume that God exists. Like the pen is red. We know that, because if pen doesn't exist, what is the point of my saying pen is red? So the moment you say God is perfect, you already accept that God is there and He is perfect. So the issue is, how do you know?
I think they are the materialistic people.
No, I mean, like, you can't expect, you know, this kind of sophistication from ordinary village.
Yeah.
But the argument is, really, next time you can show that to exist does not mean to be perfect, because existence can have many imperfections. Look at a dog, also exists. But from our point of view, dog's life is not perfect, right? Same thing. Maybe from the point of view of some Brahmas, our life is not perfect. Even in our life, some other people's life is not perfect as our life. Some people don't have legs to walk, not perfect. Somebody can't hear, not perfect. So, you know, existence is a perfect, itself is the problem.
But
it's not a perfect.
But in the time, I'm thinking in my mind, Buddhist people, they wanted to live Buddha. They pilgrimage like Buddha. And so they believe. They believe in a life in a God.
So you thought there is no difference between the two?
Yeah.
Come on. Yeah, okay. No, actually, yeah, that's good that you told us here. But, you know, that's not. When we go and worship the pagoda, worship the Buddha, we know that Buddha attained parinirvana. We don't think Buddha is somewhere in the heaven looking at us. No. We respect the Buddha. We look at the virtues of the Buddha. We don't think that Buddha is living anymore. Actually, the Sukhavati Vyuha, Pure Land Buddhism in Japan and in China, they believe that Buddha is in heaven, like God. But we don't believe. So Reverend, you have to, must be able to answer. When we go and worship the Buddha in the pagoda, we don't believe that Buddha is somewhere looking at you. No. It is for our mental purification. We think about the virtues of the Buddha. So when we think about the virtues of the Buddha, our mind become pure. Not Buddha's mind. Buddha is no more. Dead and gone. Don't worry. Buddha is nowhere.
Yeah,
but
the Buddhist people, they keep much. Buddha image, like that Buddha.
Yeah, yeah, it's true. But there is an essential difference, of course. On the one hand, you know, in religions, of course, there are certain similarities. Ordinary people may be believing that, you know, Buddha is somewhere there. But as learned people, we know that Buddha is nowhere.
Yeah.
Buddha attained parinirvana. But for ordinary people, yeah, maybe, you know, we think that may the Buddha protect us, you know. Yeah, that's not image. That's what the Buddha's doctrine. Buddha said that, you know, when I'm gone, my doctrine will be that, you know. Yeah, okay. Now, Reverend, in religious beliefs and traditions, practices, there can be certain similarities. Ordinary Buddhist, like ordinary Christian, they don't know these things, you know. So, but there is, so maybe if ordinary Buddhists think that, okay, Buddha is there to protect you, what can we do? You know, that is their belief. But in actual reality, philosophically, we know that Buddha is no more. So Buddha is not a god. Buddha was a human being who lived on earth, showed the path, taught the Dhamma, and attained Parinibbana. Finish. You know, something like that. This argument I gave you, think about it. This is a very intriguing, very puzzling argument. If the argument is successful, without much effort, you can prove that God exists. Okay? Argument has been among us more than 1,000 years. Still people debate it. You go home and think, what is this argument? What is the, how do we? So, you know, it is important for you to be able to, you know, the, understand it. And also, comment on the argument and criticize the argument from your point of view, namely at least Buddhist point of view. I showed you how to look at it from Buddhist point of view. I mean, you can go to International Encyclopedia of Philosophy and Google it, the ontological argument for the existence of God. You can know more. But try to see, try to understand why the argument is so attractive. But what is wrong with that? Okay? Any other questions? Any questions or comments? Okay, my other discussions, next discussion will not be as difficult as this discussion, so don't worry. I'll be coming to more, I mean, simple things in my next discussion on the existence of God, okay? But this argument I wanted to show you, you know, the how, you know, some tradition tried to prove the existence of God by logical argument, okay? All right, then I will wind up. And then I understand that on next third, we don't have the class. So we'll be having the class on 5th. Next class. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.